Okay, I think maybe we should get started as people are coming in. So welcome back, everyone. So we have many nice talks today and three talks in the morning in this US morning session. So the first speaker of the day is Paola Ruggiero, and she's going to tell us about quantum GHDs.
Okay, thank you. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for the nice invitation. So yes, today I would like to talk about my recent work on quantum generalized aerodynamics, which is in collaboration with Pasquale Calabrese, Ben Doyon, and Jérôme Dubail, and is in this our recent paper. So even if most of people, I think, in this conference actually know aerodynamics better than I do, probably, still I would like to start with some basics of aerodynamics, just to recall some basic facts. And so the key assumption underlying any aerodynamic theory is the one of separation of scales. And by that, what I mean is that usually one assumes separation of length scale, meaning the existence of a mesoscopic scale, small l, which is assumed to be much smaller than the macroscopic scale, so that at this length, the system can be seen locally as homogeneous, but still much larger than the microscopic scale, usually associated, say, to the interparticle distance, so that still it contains a large number of particles. Also, one assumes a time scale separation, which basically amounts to assuming a local relaxation. And the existence of such an intermediate scale is actually important because it allows us to replace the complex problem of dealing with a large number of interacting particles with the particles with the simpler problem of dealing instead with the fluid, just in terms of few local properties. And in practice, what this means is that one is allowed to do under the assumption is to replace expectation values of observables in the exact state at a given time with expectation values on a stationary state. But this stationary state is taken to be a different one for any cell in space and time. So basically, it will be position and time dependent in general. So what are these local features that we want to keep track of? Well, they are related to conservation laws that in general, for a generic system, are usually the mass, the momentum, and the energy if it's conserved. And the other assumption of aerodynamics is that they take the form of continuity equations for the associated densities. If we think to this equation as in terms of expectation values in the sense that I was explaining before, then these are exactly what people usually mean by conventional aerodynamics. But now let's move to integrable model instead, which are different in that they possess an infinite number of conservation laws. And therefore, for such models, conventional aerodynamics is not expected to apply. So first of all, what is interesting about these models is that they are exactly solvable by means of Bethe-Ansatz. But also, let me say that I would say that Bethe-Ansatz is not what I would call a flexible technique, meaning that as soon, for example, as we add some inhomogeneity in the system, then the solvability of the model breaks down. And therefore, this is one of the reasons why I think that these works that have been mentioned many times already now in this conference by Castrobaredo et al. And Bertini et al. Are quite remarkable because they need allow to treat this one-dimensional integrable system in a more versatile way. And they do that by using a hydrodynamic approach, which is nowadays called generalized hydrodynamics. So let's see what this is about. So as before, the starting point are these conservation laws, which can be shown to take the form of continuity equations also in this case. Now we have an infinite number of them. Let me remind also that in integrable models, eigenstates are labeled by a set of quantum numbers called the rapidities, which are related to the momenta of the so-called quasi-particles, meaning the stable excitation of these models. And we are interested in the thermodynamic limit in which basically these states can instead be described by now a continuous function, which can be taken to be this what is called the occupation function, basically is the occupation in this rapidity space. And now, I mean, we play the same game basically. So we want to look at the problem from a macroscopic point of view, meaning in terms of expectation values, which now will be given again in the stationary state, but which is now described by a GGE instead of a Gibbs ensemble, and still preserve this local behavior. And if we think in this term, basically what happens is that in terms of these expectation values, this infinite number of conservation laws of continuity equation can be recast in this equation for the occupation function. And this is what GHD is about. So instead of going to the details of this...
Paola?
Yes.
Ciao Giuseppe. A naive question. Usually in hydrodynamics you have Navier-Stokes equation. What kind of equation you will have here in this context?
I didn't get the question. So if you want, this is a... So you basically what you are asking, if I understand correctly, is... a relation between the usual equation of hydrodynamics, meaning the ones, let's say, for the density or for the hydrodynamic velocity, and this one. Am I correct?
Yeah, I mean, well, the Navier-Stokes is the somehow the pillars of hydrodynamics in usual sense.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm asking in this context, what kind of equation you will have?
Well, I mean, this is the equation which describes hydrodynamics in this case. I'm not sure I understood the question.
But well, Navier-Stokes is a nonlinear equation for the velocity itself. So
yes, okay, yeah. Maybe we can come back to this question later, because for a specific class of states, for example, I will show that this equation become an equation for a set of rapidities, which are, if you want, related to the momenta of the particle. So maybe it's closer to what you have in mind.
Okay.
Okay. As I was saying, instead of going to the details of this equation, I prefer to give a more intuitive picture of would help in what Giuseppe was asking for what free models are concerned. Because in this case, this equation actually become very easy to understand, meaning that when we talk about free models, then these rapidities are nothing but the momenta of the particles themselves. And this occupation function becomes the occupation function in space, also known as a Wigner function. And therefore, in this case, this equation of GHD is nothing but the evolution equation of the Wigner function, which is something that is routinely used in semi-classical methods since a long time. In this very brief overview, the last thing that I want to talk about is a special class of states in GHD, which are the zero what I will call the zero entropy states. So what are they? Basically, they are states whose occupation function is of this form. So it is one within a given contour called the Fermi contour, and it is zero outside. So first of all, let me mention that these states actually appear quite naturally, meaning that, for example, if you think to ground states within of particles of bosons within homogeneous potential, they are of this form. And what is important, what is peculiar of these states is that if we look at them locally, okay, within a given cell, let's say, then they look like a split Fermi C, okay? So they basically, they can be parameterized by just a set of Fermi points, okay, that here are this theta 1, theta 2, q. And in this case, we see that it's clear that because of this simple form of the occupation function, basically the equation for the evolution of this occupation function can be written in terms of a finite number of equations for those Fermi points. And so in this case, we end up in a finite dimensional GHD. What I mean is that usually one can think of this occupation function as an infinite number of equations, one for each theta, but now we have a finite number of them. And what is also important, and I will come back to this later in the talk, is that if we are in the special case where we only have one Fermi C, meaning just two Fermi points, okay, so this J just run from one to two, then this is these are those states for which generalized hydrodynamics actually reduce to standard hydrodynamics. This can be easily shown. Okay, so this was meant to be like just a flash of what GHD is about. Let me just mention that after the two pioneering work that I mentioned before, so a lot of activity has been going on in this field with many contributions and applications from many groups in the world. Of course, it is just a partial list, but just to say that many people are contributing to the development of this theory. Okay, and with that, I want to pass to the main part of this talk, which is about quantum hydrodynamics. So, a natural question which arises at this point is how to incorporate quantum effects in GHD. And by that, what I mean is that generalized hydrodynamics, as any theory at the hydro scale, is known to, so it's not enough, if we want to say it this way, to describe phenomena, quantum phenomena, as, for example, correlations between among different fluid cells. And this is exactly what we want to do here. So let me be very precise about what is the particular program that we have in mind here, in order to avoid confusion. So I mean, a very common and well-known procedure in literature is that of starting from classical equations. In this case, will be nothing but hydrodynamics itself, and quantize them by hand, in a sense. What I mean by that is that this path was basically the path taken by Landau, for example, who by the way was the first to first quantize a liquid in his development of the theory of superfluid helium. But after that, actually, the very same approach was also adapted to other systems, including Bose-Einstein condensate, where quantum fluctuations are captured by Bogoliubov theory, superconductors or liquid, and general liquids described by Luttinger liquid theory. And so in this sense, what we have in mind is nothing new, I would say. Let me also emphasize that so here we are not interested in going to higher order hydrodynamics, meaning we are not interested in correcting GHD equations for the GHD equations, which is instead a different path which was recently pursued, for example, by Maurizio. He actually mentioned that also in his talk the other day, when he was talking about this Moyal expansion. And similar ideas also appear, for example, in this paper by Dean Le Dussal, Majun de Rechelle. But here, this is not what we have in mind. Instead, what we want to do here is to look at the propagation of linear sound waves on top of hydrodynamics and quantize them. So in the same sense in which all these people did for other in other situations. And so when here we talk about quantum fluid, so we talk about quantum fluid in the same sense in which a Luttinger liquid is a quantum fluid. Maybe this can be more familiar to many of you. Okay, but to be more specific, to understand what to understand better what I mean, let's go to let's be specific and let's take a model, a specific model, which is in this case the Liebling-Inger model, describing repulsively interacting bosons. And let's focus again on zero entropy states. So again, the plan is to look at fluctuation around the GHD background at zero entropy one in this case, and quantize such fluctuations in a semi-classical fashion. All right, so if we start from a zero entropy state, fluctuation basically can be seen as a deformation of this Fermi contour, okay? From a local point of view, what this means is that these are nothing but fluctuation of this of the Fermi points, which in the interacting case are associated to this of a certain number of rapidities theta a. But what we do next is to switch to rapidities are not physical quantities, so we want to switch to physical momenta associated to the excitation of the model. And the main reason for doing that is that this, contrary to this theta A, this PA satisfy an exact conservation laws together with these two the associated energies. Now, if starting from this equation, we write an equation for the fluctuation of delta PA, we easily arrive to this equation. And if you look to this equation, what it's describing is exactly sound waves, linearly propagating sound waves. So it's exactly the equation we were looking for. At this point, the second point is that we want to quantize this fluctuation. And in the language of quantum fields, what this means is that one usually assume the existence of an action S whose minimum here called S classical basically gives back the wave equation, and whose expansion to second order instead gives the quantum fluctuations. So if we switch now to the Hamiltonian formalism, the main result of our work is to write down explicitly the Hamiltonian which does this job, basically. In fact, this Hamiltonian together with this commutation relation is reproduces exactly as a question of motion the wave equation that I was showing you before. So let me comment a bit about this Hamiltonian. So first of all, note that this Hamiltonian depends explicitly on the state, meaning it depends on the Fermi contour for these zero entropy states. But most importantly, note that this Hamiltonian is quadratic. And so what we are saying basically is that quantum fluctuation on top of a GHD background are captured by a quadratic theory. And this should not sound very surprising if one think in terms of a Luttinger liquid theory. And in fact, what this Hamiltonian describes is exactly a Luttinger liquid, though, a more complicated one, meaning that we see that it is explicitly time dependent, spatially inhomogeneous, and in general, multi-component. So let me also mention that what we did in this work was basically generalize our previous work with Yanis Brun and Jérôme Dubail, where basically we carried out the very same program, but in a specific, in a simpler case, if we want, which is the limit of hardcore bosons. Okay, so the same model, but the limit where the boson become hardcore, which is also known as Tong-Girardot limit. And also for a specific protocol, which was a quench from a single well to another single well with different frequency. The reason why I call this slide quantum conventional hydrodynamics is because basically this is exactly the situation where GHD actually reduced to standard hydrodynamics. And so the problem that we faced back then was to quantize in the very same sense a standard hydrodynamics. What I want to underline is that also there, as expected at this point, we ended up in a theory which was nothing but a Luttinger liquid, again, time-dependent and inhomogeneous, but this time with a single component. This is due to the fact that for this particular protocol, we are always in the situation where only two Fermi points appear, which, as I mentioned, different times now is exactly the case where generalized hydrodynamics reduced to standard hydrodynamics. Okay, so the last part, the last thing that I want to talk about is about numerical checks. I want to show you that indeed this theory works. So what we did basically, what I show you here is a numerical check for the Liebling-Inger model, and where I consider a particular protocol, which is the following. So we start in the ground state of a quartic potential, and at t equals zero, we quench to a quadratic to an harmonic potential. This protocol, if you want, is interesting also from an experimental point of view, because it's a simple way of modeling, for example, the currently running experiment or previous experiment as the quantum Newton cradle, but mainly because from this theoretical point of view, we see that if we look now at the evolution, this that I show you here is basically a movie picture. If we look to the evolution of the occupation function, we see that in this protocol, what happens is that at some time it develops more than two Fermi points. So we are in the true regime of GHD. And what I show here are basically the comparison between our theory and time-dependent DMRG. So this line is just the density profile, and so the gray lines are numerics, while the theory is the orange curve. So in this line, this is just the density. So what you see here in orange is just GHD. Instead, the new prediction are at the third and fourth line, which for different point in space show the density correlations. Well, and you see that, many features are captured already at this number of particles that we can reach with the numerics, but also stronger finite size effect are visible. So you have to take into account that here, so the numerics we can reach is up to 20 particles, which is quite far from the thermodynamic limit where we expect our theory to work better. And if you want, this can be also seen as a strength of this QGHD theory, in the sense that it works directly in the thermodynamic limit. But if you want to have a more reliable comparison, what you can do is to go to the Thomson-Girardot limit, because in that limit you can rely on free fermion techniques for the numerics. And this is what we are doing right now. And so basically, in this case, so the same, it's the same protocol, just in this limit. So you see that you can one can look at again at the density correlation. And here there is just a small point is that you need to average over a small window because to get rid of this Friedel oscillation. But apart that, the prediction of our theory perfectly match with the numerics, and in this case we were also able to go beyond that and to give an analytic expression for the entanglement entropy as a function of space and time. And we are also proceeding with the other checks of other quantities in this case. All right, so and with that, I would like to conclude with this this short summary. So I repeated after several talks that GHD indeed provide a more efficient way to describe interacting quantum particles in 1D, but still it misses important quantum effects. And I hope I convince you that GHD gives indeed a way to construct quantum fluctuation around GHD. But on the other hand, let me emphasize once again that this is not the end of the story, meaning that there are further contribution which one can take into account by considering correction to the GHD equation for the evolution itself. And with that, I would like to thank you for the attention.
Thanks a lot, Paola. It was a very nice talk. So we have a few minutes for questions.
I have a question.
Yes,
John. And it's about, even the summary. Okay, I read that there are GHD misses important quantum effects, no? Mm-hmm. And now I'm wondering that in the past, I always considered just generalized aerodynamics, and I compute the time evolution of correlation functions and entanglement entropies. So which are the quantum effects that I missed?
If you want, let me say in this way, at least this is my point of view. If you want, for example, also what you did in your talk, for example, so you use indeed GHD to compute the evolution of your quasi particle to compute entanglement or whatever, but still you need some other tool to say what are the correlations. So in my case, for example, so let me go back to the main slide, which maybe so here, if you want, from the point of view of GHD, the problem that we describe would just say that give this as initial condition, and a GHD would tell us how these initial conditions evolve.
But as far as I can understand, that the initial condition is the Fermi C. So we know that it's described by conformal field theory. There are correlations that decays as power law and so on and so forth.
Exactly. What I'm saying is that.
So
What I'm saying is that what I would call GHD, or what I would say that GHD is enough to describe, is this initial condition, okay, which has no fluctuation and nothing like that, plus, the GHD equation tells you how this initial condition evolves. What I'm saying is that now on top of that, you can consider fluctuation, but not only this fluctuation, you also have to give an Hamiltonian or an action if you want, which make them become quantum, okay? And this is exactly what we give here. I think that the way you would say this, and I would perfectly agree with you if you want, is that what we are doing is to transport in time initial correlations. And this I agree, but I don't agree on the fact that this is not what I would call a quantum theory.
Because I was just wondering what I could get more with a quantum generalized aerodynamics instead of generalized aerodynamics if I apply to my problems.
Yes. Okay. So for example, how would you? For example, you said that in your talk that your quasi-particle picture, which already already there, I would not say this is just generalized aerodynamics. I would say that it is a generalized aerodynamics plus complemented with the quasi-particle picture. I mean, but apart this, you also say that, for example, you cannot start from any state that you want. I don't know, because for example, if the state too much entangled, etc. Here, what I'm saying is that there are correlations that that you can compute in a very simple way. By the way, just because you know this Hamiltonian. So once you know this Hamiltonian, you have a mapping, for example, in the free case, in the limit of the Tongi-Girardot, what happens is that you this Hamiltonian also acquires conformal invariance, and so there you can use all the machinery to compute in a very simple way, any n particle density matrix, correlation function, any correlation function, basically you computed the entanglement as I showed. So I think that you do get something more in this sense. What you do not get is and I stressed, I think, during the talk, is that we are not correcting the GHD equation, but also, for example, not that these correlations that, for example, the density-density correlation in the Tongi-Girardot, they give a correction, if you, in my perspective, a quantum correction, which are order h bar square. And as you mentioned the other day, in the non-interacting case, you expect the first correction to the GHD equation to be proportional to the third derivative, right? So proportional to h.
Okay, only for GHD. Then there are correlation of the state that I don't know about.
Exactly. Exactly. What I'm saying, but to say that.
Okay, fine. I don't want to monopolize the discussion.
We can discuss even later. But to say that probably in many situations I would expect this kind of correlation coming from the initial state, if you want to be more important than the correction to the dynamics itself in GHD. I mean, naively, I don't know, but.
So okay, we're like a couple minutes behind, but I see we have one more question, which hopefully we can make quick. Yeah.
Should I go?
Yes, Jacopo.
Okay, so just a remark on what Giuseppe asked. So the question you're writing is the Euler equation, right? The Navier-Stokes would be by adding the viscosities, and this is what required to add the diffusion. That's what.
Okay. Sorry. In fact, I was not sure.
There are
some
differences between Navier-Stokes and GHD with diffusion. This, I mean, it's not the moment to talk about. So for me, a question is very simple. So you're in this slide, you show entanglement entropy.
Yes.
So actually, what is how do you define here the density entanglement entropy? This would be the entanglement entropy of a small interval at position x.
If you see here in each of this frame, the time is fixed. You see, and this is a function of x. So yes, it's the entropy entanglement entropy from 0 to x, and the rest.
Okay, but so this doesn't grow to, I mean, it seems
from to... minus infinity to x.
From minus infinity to x.
Sorry. So it remains of order one, right? You don't generate, you don't go to a...
No, well, no, in this case, you don't expect, because basically you are starting from a ground state. So you're starting from the ground state of... in the double well, and then you are quenching just the potential. So in this case, you don't expect to generate.
Okay, but this you cannot get from quasi particle picture. I mean, it's something that you need.
No, I don't think so, because I mean, the trivial answer would be, I mean, since it doesn't grow linearly, I don't think you can get by quasi particle picture. Still, I'm not sure that everything that is not linear cannot be captured by quasi-particle picture. I mean, in particular, after this idea of working in the curved space and whatever, but I don't think so. I don't think so.
Sorry. All right. Move
on to the next talk, though, since we're a few minutes behind, then we can leave questions for the discussion session. So let's thank Paolo again.